Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back. I'm so happy to meet you again in this great role of critical care ultrasound in management of COVID-19 acute respiratory failure case 2. First, we are all learning from COVID-19. And I can say from the cases I've seen that you can expect any cause of cardiopulmonary derangement as a possible cause of your patient deterioration, and you will see that in the coming cases very clearly. Attention. Is there really a two types of COVID-19 lung pathology causing acute respiratory failure, or it is one type with different presentation according to severity, and it is simply a natural progression of the same disease? Let us see. A 50-year-old male patient, diabetic, admitted to our medical department due to COVID-19 pneumonia. 3 days later, he complained of severe shortness of breath and admitted to our ICU. He was fully conscious, cooperative, hemodynamically stable, blood pressure 120 over 70, heart rate 90 per minute regular, sinus respiratory rate from 30 to 35 per minute, O2 saturation 82% on 15 liter non-rebreathing mask, heart S1, S2, chest bilateral crackle, abdomen soft legs. We sent all chemistry and hematology and started critical care ultrasound for COVID-19 in ICU. First, inferior vena cava. As you see here, patient is tachypneic. Inferior vena cava is very narrow and totally collapsing. Marrow totally collapsing. Attention, please. All cases I have seen were dehydrated on admission to ICU. Possible causes: high insensible water loss due to fever and tachypnea in previous days before admission. Some cases have diarrhea, poor oral intake. But really, almost all patients I've seen on admission ICU were dehydrated, significantly dehydrated. And I believe this is main factor for acute renal failure. Second, the heart. Attention, please. Transthoracic echo in COVID-19 acute respiratory failure is very tricky because of a lot of air in the lung and the high positive pressure with high beep in ventilated patient. So remember two things, please. First, consider subcostal view. Second, in my limited experience, look for the common finding in COVID-19, which are common finding in echocardiography in COVID-19. For my experience, is kissing heart denoting hypovolemia, right side dilatation denoting acute corpopulmonary because of acute respiratory failure and the microthrombosis of pulmonary circulation, and stress myopathy and myocarditis in some cases, but really not too much. Long external long axis parasternal view, kissing heart, good contraction. Parasternal short axis view, kissing heart, good contraction, and right side is not dilated. Third, this patient serves the lung. This patient is tolerating severe hypoxia and he is calm with no signs of severe respiratory distress, and he is raising the wind sign by his thumb. He is feeling well and X-ray revealing mild infiltrate, so you can consider him L-type. You see the X-ray on admission? A lot of air. There is opacity, basal opacity, but really there is a lot of aerated area in the lung, and I believe the lung ultrasound will be rediscovered after COVID-19. From the cases I have seen, lung ultrasound can be very helpful in diagnosis, triaging, following treatment, and decision for weaning. Really, we should all thank this professor Daniel Lichtenstein for his great discovery of lung ultrasound. Thank you, Professor Daniel. this 20 of April, on the day, first day or second day in admission, yani when I saw the patient, this is right upper midclavicular lung area, as you see here, the sick pleura of COVID-19 with dense B-line, you can give a score of 2 for this right upper midclavicular area. Right lower midclavicular area, you can see B line with spare area, B line with spare area nearby, B line with spare A area nearby, you can give score of 1. Right upper mid axillary, sick pleura, dense B line, you give score 2. This is all on 20 April. Right lower mid axillary also dense B line with sick pleura. You see left side, this is the left lower midclavicular, left upper midclavicular, you can give 2 points for both. This all was 20 of April. Left upper mid axillary with left lower mid axillary, you can give 2 scores for both. You see here subpleural consolidation, dense B line. Here subpleural consolidation, dense B line. Most of the more than 50% of the screen is B line. You can give a score 2. Right upper posterior axillary, you can give dense B line here. You can give 2 and O line or. And if there is absence of A line and B line, you can mention O line and give score 0. Left upper posterior axillary, 2. Left lower posterior axillary, 0. So it is a game of B line. I can say COVID-19 pneumonia is a game of B line. This patient has lung score of 17. But please take care. For my opinion, not all B lines are the same. You see here, this sick pleura and this B line and this B line. Here, echogenicity is different. And in this patient, you see B line dense echogenic B line. This less echogenic B line. I believe this will be early, and in the later stage, you will get this echogenic dense B line and subpleural consolidation. So, not all B lines the same. B line with subpleural consolidation is bad in prognosis. B line, echogenic B line with more echogenicity has bad prognosis compared to the B line with failed echogenicity. It's not too much. What else makes this patient happy? What else let us consider this patient an L type, not H type? Well moving diaphragm, good diaphragmatic movement, denoting good lung compliance. This at all at 20 of April. Investigation came, relative lymphopenia, coagulation within normal, D-dimer 0.7, microgram per liter 0.76, LDH is rising, albumin low side, mild increase in liver enzymes, otherwise it's okay. ABG, BH 7.51, BCO2 32, BO2 51, O2 saturation 84, bicarb 21, respiratory alkalosis because of hypoxemic respiratory alkalosis and the very bad BF ratio. We use to use end-tidal CO2 monitoring for all our patients with arterial line because it is very important point here. Please look for the difference between end-tidal BCO2 and barge and arterial BaCO2 of the arterial sample. The difference between entidal BCO2 and the arterial BCO2, if this difference is too much, if the arterial sample BCO2 is more than entidal BCO2 by more than 10, 15, that means your patient have increased dead space and you should consider vascular element in this patient. But in our patient, entidal BCO2 is 28, and the arterial BCO2 32, so the difference is within normal limit, denoting no dead space, denoting that this patient, which is L type, but the pathology is interstitial infiltrate. The pathology is interstitial infiltrate pneumonitis, but early pneumonitis. So the compliance is still is good. Summary. A case of COVID-19 pneumonia with type 1 acute respiratory failure, severe hypoxemia with BF less than 100, hypovolemia as evidenced by very narrow inferior vena cava kissing heart, will moving diaphragm denoting good compliance, patient has probably L type. This is really the common early scenario in ICU of all cases I have seen, which is not severe cases, not H type cases, but as you see here, the difference between entidal BCO2 and the arterial BCO2 is less than 5. That means the no dead space, no vascular, no significant vascular element here. The main pathology is inflammation, is interstitial inflammation by B-line and the lung water of 17 score. Patient was treated according to our protocol in Ministry of Health. He was connected to CPAP 12. Non-invasive, he received boluses of intravenous of fluid of balanced crystalloid, which is Ringer lactate, followed by 150 cc per hour Ringer lactate. Patient was followed daily by critical care ultrasound to assess the lung water and hemodynamic status by looking at inferior vena cava and renal perfusion. Really, this type of patient is fully conscious, cooperative, can maintain his airway without secretion because it's dry cough. We take the airborne precaution and connect the patient to non-invasive CPAP. We need this patient to breathe spontaneously. We need this patient to breathe with negative pressure breathing to improve recruitment, to improve hemodynamics, to improve blood flow, venous return. And at the same time, this patient has no contraindication to CPAP, and we consider the tidal volume. We be sure that tidal volume is not too much in this patient. So what we are going to do for this patient, we are recruiting this patient and put him in the proper pressure volume curve point and keep him breathe spontaneously to maintain the cooperation of the patient, to maintain the well-being, to maintain the diaphragmatic movement. And at the same time, we are following the success or failure of CPAP by Hacker score, which is very, we see very valuable in our patient to see for Hacker score every 6 hours to know that the patient is doing well. If the score is less than 5, that means the patient is in the proper track and we are doing the proper thing. We follow our patient, as you see here, at the 20 April. This right upper midclavicular day 1, it is B line, dense B line, score 2. In day 2, 21, still dense B line. In day 3, started to be separated B line, very faint B line, denoting recruitment and improvement of the patient. You see in another segment here, lower left upper midclavicular day 1. Dense B line, score 2, in 21, still dense. After, in third day, it's A line, score 0. So, we are following the progress of our patient because once the lung water is dropped below 12, we start the weaning of CPAP. Attention, please. Hemodynamic management is a cornerstone in management of this patient. Please keep your patient on dry side with well perfused vital organ, which is the kidney. As you see here, this patient on the third day is still in pure vena cava, is not full, is still in the dry side, CVV almost 5, but you see in the day 2, the kidney is well perfused, and this is our goal. My inferior vena cava is narrow collapsing. Your inferior vena cava is narrow collapsing, but you need to be sure that vital organ is doing well with this patient. Okay, this is very important. Look for especially the kidney, because the kidney is the first vital organ to suffer in hypoperfusion. And you see here, this is the resistivity index, and this is the Doppler, spectral Doppler of the renal branches. You see very good diastolic flow denoting this kidney is well perfused. And I believe will be very helpful for you to go to my case report about the value of monitoring vital organ blood flow by full Doppler study during shock. And in this case study, I did all the Doppler study for the liver, for the brain, for the kidney, and we discovered that the kidney is the first organ to suffer in shock. It suffered before the brain and before the liver. And if you need to know about the kidney and the resistivity index and the importance of the ultrasound for acute renal failure to help you in diagnosing the acute renal failure in COVID patient, I believe if you go to my protocol, which is published in the Emerging Medicine and the Critical Care Special Issue, the great value of critical care ultrasound in management of acute kidney injury in ICU will be very helpful. And there is a very important reference about the role of renal ultrasound in acute kidney injury. In the fourth day, patient was disconnected from CPAP and was doing well on oxygen mask and transferred to medical ward. Thanks to God. Attention, please. You need always to keep your patient happy. This patient on CPAP is rising the wind sign, and after removing the CPAP, he is rising the wind sign. Always watch your patient. Always keep your patient safe and keep your patient happy and reassure him. It's very, very, very important in the treatment of this type of patient, I believe. And attention, please. Lastly, is there really a two types of COVID-19 lung pathology causing acute respiratory failure, or it's one type with different presentation according to severity, and it's simply a progression of the same disease? Let us see. Professor Gattanoni himself will answer for these questions. If you see in the critical care publication, he mentioned very clearly in 20 to 30% of these COVID-19 patients admitted towards the intensive care unit, severe hypoxemia is associated with compliance value less than 40 millicentimeter water, indicating severe ARDS. It's certainly possible that their lower compliance, lower gas volume, and increased recurability is due to the natural evolution of the disease. Is due to the natural evolution of the disease, but we cannot exclude the other possibility. But he mentioned very clearly that natural evolution of the disease will convert the L type to the H type. And I believe this is the most so probably the explanation of the patient deterioration. And thank you a lot for your watching. See you in another third case of COVID-19 series. Bye-bye.